Welcome back. I'm Brindis Hofther's daughter, and it is my pleasure to introduce our next moderator. Dr. Nilgun Bayraktar is an assistant professor of film history, theory, and criticism in the visual studies program at CCA. Her work focuses on migrant and diasporic cinema in Europe, experimental and avant-garde cinema, screen-based art, and performance. She received a BA in cultural studies from Sabancı University in Istanbul and a PhD in performance studies with a designated emphasis in film and media studies from the University of California, Berkeley. Her recently published book, Mobility and Migration in Film and Moving Image Art, Cinema Beyond Europe, examines cinematic and artistic representations of migration and mobility in Europe since the 1990s. At CCA, Nilgun teaches courses on film history, cinematic cities, migration, and art. Please join me in a round of applause.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. It's a great pleasure for me to be here today. Please excuse my voice. I'm recovering from a cold. The title of our panel today is Unsettled Legacies, Undermining Colonial Rhetoric Through Strategic Art Practice. First, I'll introduce all our panelists, and then they will present. So the first panelist today is Jesus Barraza. Jesus is an interdisciplinary artist and visual critic with a BA in Raza Studies from San Francisco State University. He's the co-founder of Dignidad Rebelde, which is a graphic arts collaborative, and a member of Just Seeds Artist Cooperative. From 2003 to 10, he was a partner at Tumis Design Studio. In September 2013, Barraza participated in a Leeway Foundation's Revolve, an Art for Social Change Symposium, on the panel Embedded in Community, What's Social Practice? In 2015, along with his partner, he received the Community Recognition Award from the National Association of Chicana and Chicano Studies. His prints and posters have been exhibited nationally and internationally. The second presenter, Ekin Balcıoğlu. She is an interdisciplinary artist born in Izmir, Turkey. She holds a BA in fashion design from Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design in London, and is currently pursuing a dual degree, MA and MFA in visual and critical studies and fine arts at CCA. Her artistic practice employs ideas that are often subversive and polemical in nature, exploring political, social, cultural codes, and focusing on depicting marginalization and resistance to oppressive systems. Her work has circulated in solo and group exhibitions, both nationally and internationally, and she is a co-recipient of an Impact Social Entrepreneurship Award from CCA Center for Art and Public Life for the project To Lemon Hill, a tutoring program for Syrian refugee children in Izmir, as well as a Murphy and Cadogan Contemporary Art Award. Our third presenter, Brindis Hoftostadter. Brindis was born in Boston and as a teenager moved to Reykjavik, Iceland. She received a BA in European Cultural Studies from Brandeis University in 2012. At Brandeis, she specialized in German and Soviet cinema and literature and researched the ways in which art addresses the effects of totalitarian oppression and war. After graduation, she worked for ArtSpeak and the Vancouver Community Arts Council in Canada, and for Hvervis Gallery in Iceland. Her most recent academic projects concern nationalism, post-nationalism, immigration, exclusion, and belonging. Her writings can be found in Art Practical. Please join me welcoming our panelists today. Okay. So the title of Jesus's work is Lowriding a Social Form, Anishinaabe Grandfather Teachings as Decolonial Vehicles of Resistance.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us this afternoon. One of the most interesting revelations of my research this year was coming across the Red River Cart, created by the Métis, the indigenous people from the area known today as Manitoba, Canada. The wooden cart was widely used throughout the plains in the 19th century to haul buffalo meat and hides during their yearly hunts. The Métis also used it to move their belongings when they were forced to migrate from Canada into the United States, a move that occurred through the demise of the bison hunt and the influx of European settlers. But my presentation is not entirely about this cart. Instead, the main focus here is lowrider bikes. These bikes have their origins in Chicano car clubs that work together to customize lowrider cars, go cruising, and show off their artistic skills at competitions. This process of collective making inspired lowriders, lowrider bikes as an alternative for those too young to drive cars. Like the cars, these are built in small groups or clubs that go cruising through their neighborhood to show off their work. But how do we get from the Red River Cart to these lowrider bikes? The connections between the two may seem apparent. They are both simple two-wheeled machines without fuel-powered engines. Both are easy to take apart and put back together, allowing for customization. And both are inspired by European means of transportation, but upgraded with indigenous materials. What isn't as apparent is how these bikes help indigenous youth work through a process of decolonization and learn about indigenous cultures from the Great Lakes area. To demonstrate how this process of decolonization was set in motion, I'm going to introduce Dylan Minder's ongoing art project, Native Kids Ride Bikes. This work started in 2011, and over the past 5 years has gone through various iterations based in the US and Canada. In this presentation, I am focusing on the first series of workshops held in East Lansing, Michigan, in collaboration with high school students from the Indigenous Youth Empowerment Project and East Lansing High School's Native American Club. Minder focused the project to work with intertribal youth, using workshops to teach them about the history and culture of Indigenous people in the Great Lakes area where he was raised. For this series of workshops, Minder invited Anishinaabe elders and adults and college students to work with the youth participants. Together, this intergenerational group held discussions about the history and cultures of local Indigenous people, specifically the Anishinaabe, whose seven grandfather teachings guiding the workshop. In this collaborative space, the participants came together over 6 months to produce a series of seven lowrider bikes. These were exhibited at Michigan State University's Lookout Gallery in the fall of 2011. I propose that Native Kids Ride Bikes uses workshops and lowrider bikes as part of a socially engaged decolonial process, using historical and cultural teachings as tools of resistance to cultural disintegration and to reintroduce knowledge and traditions that were once part of everyday life but have nearly been lost. Implementing this strategy, Minder uses bikes in a process of recovering traditional cosmologies while remaining grounded in the contemporary realities of detribalization, displacement, and globalization. To define a socially engaged decolonial practice, I show how Native Kids Ride Bikes connects participants with an Anishinaabe worldview of sustainability, a way of approaching the world that sees all living things as connected and requires each other for continued survival. Participants learn to consider the importance of people-powered vehicles as alternatives to fossil fuel-burning modes of transportation. Through Minder's methodology of visiting, I show how he uses workshops to bring youth participants together with elders, creating a space of collaboration, conversation, and making in which everyone contributes to the design and construction of the bikes. It is through these workshops that I show how Minder uses a decolonial pedagogy with the seven grandfather teachings to generate a dialogue with participants about indigenous culture. Through this approach, I demonstrate how Minder incorporates a decolonial process in his work and puts forth a strategy to reconnect youth with cultures and traditions indigenous to where they live. To help define a decolonial practice, I propose decolonization is a process that actively challenges the reduction of indigenous people for racial classification that subjectifies them and turns them into less than human beings. This definition captures the disconnection faced by indigenous people from their history, culture, and spirituality. As Gerald Taike Alfred claims, this spiritual disconnection leads to disintegration and deculturing of indigenous people. Through Native Kids Ride Bike, Minor uses a decolonial process to help youth connect with indigenous teachings through making art. To get a full picture of this project, I take us back to the Red River cart. Minor first came across this cart in 2010 while conducting research at the Smithsonian's National Museum of the American Indian. This was done through a research grant he received from the museum to study indigenous modes of transportation used in the Great Lakes area in the 18th and 19th century. Specifically, to learn how his ancestors traveled before fossil fuel burning cars and coal burning trains were introduced in the area. In turn, this research inspired Miner's Native Kids Ride Bikes, using the Red River cart as a model for his project to teach young people about living in a way that doesn't harm the environment. As models of environmental sustainability, the bikes were the starting point of the project, but Miner didn't select just any bikes. He chose to incorporate lowrider bikes, which he learned to build in his youth with neighborhood friends. For Miner, Chicano lowriding is an indigenous way of moving through the world that contrasts the speed needed to succeed in the contemporary capitalist world. In this manner, lowriders provide the youth with a different way of looking at the world that isn't focused on moving through life as fast as possible. Instead, the bike's slow pace inspires them to use their body to power the vehicle and take time to experience the world around them. But the project wasn't only about creating lowrider bikes. Miner brought the group together to learn and make things as a way of building community. This way of making art is not only focused on making objects. It includes active engagement through group participation that results in experiences that become part of the artwork. For Miner, this participatory experience is a focus of his methodology of visiting, used as a guide for many of his projects. What this means is that the workshops are used to bring youth participants together with elders and create a space of collaboration, conversation, and making where everyone is able to contribute to the design and constructions of the bikes. In this manner, the workshops provide a space where aesthetics are explored through hands-on experience that includes conversations about Anishinaabe cultural materials and forms like the deer hide drum, the Métis panel bag, peyote stitch beading, and leather working. Through this pedagogical relationship with making, participants engage with each other while learning about the history of these crafts and how they relate to people's everyday lives. As part of this process, participants were introduced to the seven grandfather teachings. These are composed by the following seven concepts: wisdom, love, respect, bravery, truth, humility, and honesty. This series of teachings were a basic part of Anishinaabe culture that provided people with the basic tools to live their lives. And each bike that was built reflect one of these teachings. Looking at the lead bike presented in the exhibition, we can see how it embodies one of these concepts. The lowrider is decorated with a wooden birch basket on the handlebars that is used to collect berries in the forest. An eagle staff antenna on the back, which is a symbol for integrity and honor of a warrior, and painted buckskin wheel covers that represent a drum and the heartbeat of Mother Earth. The decorations used on the bike draw from cultural traditions that the students learned about in the workshops. Alone, they each have a purpose, but placed together, I see them embody the teaching of respect. The bike they created is a warrior's vehicle, made for a person who respects all living things, and whose sense of respect serves as a drive to continue the struggle to protect the people and the environment. The person who rides his bike understands they must put others before themselves. But the teachings are never standalone ideas. They work in conjunction with each other. In this manner, respect is also tied to love. Because without love for all living things, a warrior cannot find respect for life. Through this presentation, I have shown how the Red River cart led to a series of youth lowrider bikes, how its environmental friendly technology served as inspiration to teach youth about building bikes as an alternative to fossil fuel burning cars that are polluting our world. And by bringing together the intergenerational group using his methodology of visiting, Minor creates a space of communal learning and bike building where youth participants learn about the indigenous history of the crafts based in these communities. Lastly, using the grandfather teachings, the participants learn about decolonizing and reconnecting with indigenous cultures, learning the lessons necessary to live a good life while working together in community to produce beautiful art, using their body to power the bikes they built and experience the world as they move slowly through space. Right on, thank you.
Good afternoon. At the beginning, there is nothingness. A few seconds pass with just a plain black screen. Speaking philosophically, a female voice breaks the stillness. It announces the lines that encapsulate the most fundamental views underlying the perspective of the Irish artist Duncan Campbell's 54-minute essay film, It for Others.
Objects exist outside of us. It is the confrontation of mind with matter that brings an object into being. Through their use, they provide subsistence, satisfy other human wants, and become the means and processes to produce more objects. The wealth of our societies exists as a vast accumulation of objects.
Divided into four segments, It for Others features an array of artifacts from West Africa, a dance performance by Michael Clark Company, images of household objects, and archival footage from Northern Ireland. The work references other artists and filmmakers, including Chris Marker, Alain René, Stephen Shore, and Sergei Eisenstein, each in different ways invested in a critique of capitalism. All the images you will see, unless noted, are from the film. Despite initially starting as a post-colonialist criticism of British museums, as you can see through the text within the frame, the film is impressively richer. The work is a model of self-expression that tackles the problem of display, which is the question, how could museums not impose their will and thereby enact cultural imperialism on objects they collect and display? It for Others exemplifies a possible answer in its being that demonstrates signs of colonial subjecthood. Campbell stages in the film his views on the problem of display by yielding it as a subject that resists being defined by others. Campbell's film self-referentially deals with its own making and itself as a museum displaying objects. Since a display of objects which come into being elsewhere is representing something that exists in a context in another context, a display is recontextualization. As such, museums perform recontextualization that leads to impoverishing and imperializing cultures. It for Others acts like an ideal museum that actively tries to overcome such problems. The opening of the film historicizes its discussion in contextualizing its objects by pointing at a particular object. The female voice speaks again. This is a film about objects. It refers to another film about objects, specific African objects, a ballad of their mortality and death, Le Statue Meronossi. It for Others refers to Le Statue Meronossi, statues also die, as its model object. In situating its discussion around statues also die's contemporary context, the work starts a moment from the past. As the film progresses, it shifts to present. Marker and René's 1953 essay film, Statues Also Die, offers insight into damaging cultural impact of colonization, on how African art is perceived and removed from its original source and objectified. Statues Also Die depicts the Western museums as colonial structures that impose their will on the objects they display. It for Others begins with moments that are reenactments and recreations of Statues Also Die. In the first part of the film, Campbell creates a sophisticated reflexive meditation on appropriation of African artifacts. through the discussion within Statues Also Die, we see how certain contexts necessitate the emergence of colonial subjects, displayed through the post-colonial context West Africa and the emergent negritude movement. Along the way, we are promised that it furthers manages a way out of the problem of display and how it does so. The voiceover reads, "Nothing prevents us from being the inheritors of two pasts if they meet with equality in the present." The film ends with this promise. We are told that it is possible only through an untraditional and complex manner, vaguely stated as meeting in the present. It promises, like a subject, that it would handle the problem by meeting with the viewer in the present. In what seems to be a reference to Jean-Paul Sartre, the title of the film refers to itself. It states of itself that it for others is a thing who is being is for others. Its value is for others to determine. However, just as the rest of the film, the title generates paradox as soon as we realize that through its working, it declares and forces its own being, thereby contradicting what it named declares. In Being and Nothingness, Sartre discusses notions such as being for others, being for itself, and being in itself. In a simplified manner, a being in itself is a being whose value is closed within itself. A being for others is a being whose value is defined by others, hence its being is for others to determine. Lastly, a being for itself is a being who resists being defined by others and exists to self-define its own being. In a sense, Sartre's being for itself is more or less synonymous with my use of subject. At one point, the film declares that a subject is, materially, a complex series of conditioned reflexes with a demonstration of the mechanism of associative thinking. Campbell materializes to his views on the problem of display by yielding it for others as a being for itself, namely a subject, that resists being defined by others, because given the philosophical obstacles and the historical context, this is the only possible way in which an artist can resist. In Michael Clark's segment, dancers illustrate Karl Marx's equations and diagrams that represent his labor theory of value. The film turns its focus onto the historical preconditions that lead up to the conditions that breed colonial subjects. In tracing the problem towards its presumed root, Campbell wishes to show that cultural imperialism is rooted in economic factors. Behind the objects that we contact through their aesthetic features, there lays their history, politics, and economic interests. The Clark section reveals the historical materialist mind behind the discussion at hand. Shifting the concentration further towards Marx's ideas, It for Others moves to its third chapter, The General Object. This chapter utilizes images from Stephen Shore's photographs and animations from TV advertisements to depict the history of the world of commodities. Campbell demonstrates how our everyday lives are filled with encounters with aesthetic objects as commodities and urges us to look beyond their aesthetic features. In a plain and simple setting, we see a hand putting a can reading Campbell's Condensed Tomato Soup, as the title of the part, The General Object, appear in a large white font. Campbell's Condensed is a self-reference to It Furthers Itself as condensing Campbell in its being. Just as Campbell makes use of repetitive images at the aesthetic level to signal more abstract notions, so does he use other still images at the aesthetic level to signal abstract ideas. As the voiceover speaks along the scene, the maximum abstractness of an expanding idea appears particularly bold when presented as an offshoot from extreme concreteness, the banality of the stuff of everyday life. It for Others, an object, is Campbell, a subject, condensed. It is indeed bold. Campbell reveals the most general structure guiding his creation, the method of dialectics. The voiceover reads, "It's still very complicated to think in extra thematic imagery, however, to show the method of dialectics. Through the creation of montages between seemingly incoherent parts, Campbell opens a space for the viewer to explore further by association. The dialectic proceeds through the multidimension and ties the fragments to each other, unfolding from past to present. The film embodies the multidimensional of the reality it displays and blurs polarities like subject-object, form-content, and life-death that might otherwise fix it within a colonial narrative. At an exemplary moment, Campbell recreates a simple photograph of Stephen Shore, in which a cup of coffee stands on a light wooden table as a hand enters in the frame and puts a cup of coffee on the table. The hand enters in again, and this time puts Shore's photograph within the frame, thereby making us see a frame within a frame. We hear the following line: "The elements, the material objects of his comings and goings, serve as points of departure for the forming of associations, through which the play of concepts become possible." Not only Campbell thus generates a complicated referential connection between the recreated cup and its original image, but also we are led to see how it intends to make possible its disclosure to the viewer in depending on associations. The fourth and final chapter, Reflexes, presents archival footage from the Irish Troubles, an ethno-nationalist conflict that blighted Northern Ireland in the early 1970s. Reflexes is titled subtly, referencing the material's interpretation of a subject. By juxtaposing media representations and his personal commentary, Campbell points at the economic factors behind the manipulative and interest-governed display of events. Campbell's historical context, Northern Ireland, is suggested to be a colonial context, not because it's equivalent to West Africa in all matters, but due to their shared historical factors that yield them as what they are today. This discussion connects to the suggestion that the contemporary British art world, too, is such a context. Through the associations, the suggestion at issue becomes manifest. As an Irish artist, Campbell sees himself to be a colonial subject forced to self-express. The film stands as an art object that is symbolic colonial subject or like an avatar in the British art world, paralleling Campbell. Through the parallels established between Campbell and It for Others, the latter is revealed to transcend its aesthetic features and emerge as a being for itself. Yet, still it can't escape being objectified exactly as it speaks out in its last scene, namely by being valued in terms of a price tag. The film is valued by Turner Prize in 2014, just as it discusses the valuation of objects within contemporary art market being the objectified effect of pricing. Nevertheless, through the dialectical method, the work becomes a model of display. It behaves like an exemplary museum in narrowing the gap between the original and the appropriated context. Ultimately, It for Others doesn't solve the problem straightforwardly. Rather, its solution is to bring the viewer into the awareness of the problem's scope. The viewer is part of the problem because the problem is not just one-sided problem that could be solved in any way of representing, since representing itself is the problem. The film transcends itself and speaks to the viewer, saying that the viewer is, in the present, part of the colonization, knowingly or not. Like a Trojan horse, once It for Others is opened up, it pulls its viewer into the already existent problem. It wakes you up. Thank you.
Hello again. I first saw God a couple years ago. I stood with my parents and a few strangers in a small dark room, and we heard this.
Sorrow and conquers.
The man we heard was so earnest and sang with such emotion that some of us started to laugh uncomfortably, and the rest of us were moved to tears. And I knew that this was an experience that was going to follow me for some time. God is a video installation by a contemporary Icelandic artist named Ragnar Kjartansson. The installation is based on a live performance piece titled Sorrow Conquers Happiness, which Kjartansson debuted in Iceland in 2004 and has performed throughout Europe in the 12 years since. In both the live performance and video installation, Kjartansson repeatedly sings this phrase, Sorrow Conquers Happiness, to a half-hour-long, subtly morphing melody composed by his friend David Thor Jonsson. When Kjartansson completes his rendition of the song, he repeats it again and again for 7 hours straight. Kjartansson is one of Iceland's most successful artists. His installations have been exhibited at Palais de Tokyo, the New Museum, the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and the Venice Biennale. One of his works was recently acquired by SF MoMA. He is often chosen to represent the Icelandic art scene at festivals, and he's ideally suited to illustrate it. Ask an arts professional who has knowledge of the contemporary Icelandic art scene to characterize it, and you'll hear a persistent refrain. Art made in Iceland is unorthodox, unpredictable, unrestrained. Kjartansson's gallerist, Bergur Arnarsson, claims that contemporary Icelandic artists are unfettered by tradition, discipline, and context. Elsewhere in the world, artists continue to extend or react against established local conventions, but Arnarsson says that in Iceland, there's a freedom to try whatever you want and to get away with it. In 2004, an Icelandic artist named Gabriela Friðriksdóttir collaborated with Kjartansson on the performance we see here. In Ode to Bippi Mortens, the two artists clad themselves in nylon stockings and bread slippers and sang a song in honor of one of Iceland's most prolific folk musicians. Friðriksdóttir credits her own artistic ingenuity to the freedom Icelandic people have because of the lack of tradition. In Iceland, she says, there's an enormous space of nothingness where local convention and cultural customs would usually reign. In 2013, Ragnar Kjartansson and the 12 other Icelandic artists pictured here acted out a scene from Roman mythology at MoMA PS1. Using a foam machine, vacuum cleaner, garbage can, and inflatable whale, these artists created a musical performance that told the story of Venus's birth from sea foam. German art historian Dr. Christian Schön asserts that this whole generation of Icelandic artists displays a refreshingly disrespectful approach to art history. He says that if anything typifies art made in Iceland, it is its devotion to universally popular trends. I would argue that in its unboundedness, the work of Icelandic artists is prototypically post-national. Jürgen Habermas defines post-nationalism as the end result of a historically momentous dynamic, which follows an abstraction from local to national to democratic consciousness and could culminate in a globalized society that transcends the affective ties of nation, language, place, and heritage. According to Habermas, a post-national society may be expected to take into account the autonomy, particularity, and uniqueness of formerly sovereign states and create a new multiplicity of interconnected cultures. The post-national is the rich and productive interpermeation of local and global forces. But the current discourse surrounding Kjartansson's art and Icelandic visual culture in general leads us to believe that it has severed its ties to a heritage, that it is utterly unbeholden to any local or national expectations, and that there is no such thing as Icelandic art. When Arnarson, Fredriksdóttir, and Schön claim that art made in Iceland is unencumbered by local tradition, they suggest that its significance and global relevance depends on the emergent insignificance and irrelevance of its national borders and history. They assert that art made in contemporary Iceland bubbles up out of a cultural vacuum or an enormous space of nothingness. And in doing so, they locate it at the extreme end of a spectrum, safely out of the reach of nationalism, but also far beyond post-nationalism, at a point where local and national influences are not just de-romanticized, but totally devalued and perhaps even non-existent. This discourse threatens to homogenize Iceland's best-known art into a kind of global monoculture, erasing its singularity rather than acknowledging its place in a Habermasian constellation of hybridized cultures. Such declarations can be dangerous, for when we interpret art within an exclusively global rather than post-national framework, some of its poetic nuances are lost. We close ourselves off to certain interpretations of art that are affecting and constructive. Let's return to God. Most of Kjartansson's artworks, including God, center on a discrete phrase or gesture, an episode. This episode usually cites the work of another artist, like Kjartansson's friend Jónsson, and feels well worn. The words "sorrow conquers happiness" call to mind stereotypically depressed Scandinavians, like the Norwegian painter Edvard Munch or the melancholy Dane Hamlet. And the episode is rendered in one of several conventional pop cultural styles. In God, Kjartansson's sleek getup, big band, and glamorous backdrop emulate those of Rat Pack crooners like Bing Crosby, Frank Sinatra, and Dean Martin. All of Kjartansson's performances last hours, days, months, or even years. Each performance of Sorrow Conquers Happiness is just a fragment of a long, evolving project that extends over a decade and across oceans. When Kjartansson performed in a restaurant in Reykjavik, Iceland in 2004, he sang in English and a local jazz trio accompanied him. But when he sang in an elegant train station in St. Petersburg, Russia in 2014, his performance took on a different tone. He sang in Russian, supported by a chamber orchestra and police choir. Because critics and curators operate on the premise that Icelandic art has no local precedent, they often associate specific elements of Kjartansson's strategy with primary features of international postmodernism. They associate his use of appropriation with pastiche and his work's episodic looping with the schizophrenic conception of time. According to curator Cecilia Alemani, for example, when Kjartansson dons the guise of a Rat Pack crooner, his mimicry is detached and empty. It preserves none of the connotations that originally saturated the Rat Pack style and generates none of its own. She compares God to a cabaret performance by a vaudevillian idiot savant. Understood within a postmodern framework, Kjartansson's work is neutral parody, in which elements of the past are replicated without nostalgia and without any particular concern for their import. But what would happen if we allowed ourselves to associate Kjartansson's strategy with elements of Icelandic culture? Iceland celebrates a long storytelling tradition. For almost a millennium, Icelanders passed down stories orally, often in the form of melodic alliterative poetry. Even today, Icelanders perform traditional poems and informally compose alliterative verse to commemorate notable events. Like Kjartansson's performances, traditional Icelandic poems are episodic, appropriative, and structured through repetition. Musicologist Hreinn Steingrímsson has described how pre-modern Icelandic performers composed stanzas that they either repeated again and again or combined with other modular episodes to comprise a musical performance that lasted hours, days, weeks, or even months. According to Steingrímsson, these pre-modern performers regularly cited the work of their peers and predecessors to conserve and celebrate valuable cultural lore. They also often translated foreign stories, committed them to alliterative verse, and infused them with references to local mythology so that the context would be accessible to their countrymen. Once foreign texts, like the Protestant Catechism or 1001 Nights, had been tailored to local audiences, they became common knowledge and part of the local canon. If we assume that Kjartansson is repurposing this Icelandic tradition for an international fine arts community, we see that his art may be understood to celebrate and preserve its influences rather than empty them of their original meaning. His work interlaces his friend's melody with Scandinavian sadness, with the style of American crooners with his own intonations, and does so in such a way that it can be adapted to the vernacular of each audience who sees him perform, no matter where they are in the world, no matter whether they are in a Reykjavik restaurant, a Russian train station, or perhaps a gallery in New York or in San Francisco. Kjartansson's work likely draws on both global postmodernism and pre-modern Icelandic traditions. The problem with relegating Kjartansson's work exclusively to a form of international postmodernism is that the significance of the work in acknowledging, penetrating, and transcending the affective ties of nation, language, place, and heritage may be overlooked. His work moves us all to tears or laughter. When we acknowledge contemporary art's rootedness in a national cultural heritage, we come closer to achieving a Habermasian post-nationalist ideal than when we deny and devalue those roots. Thank you.
Thank you so much for such a great panel and amazing and thought-provoking presentations. So I prepared a little response because I had the privilege of reading these papers beforehand. After my response, I will ask a few questions and then I will open the floor for audience questions. Art matters in many, many different ways. In my view, our panelists today wonderfully explored the ways in which art can present itself as an insightful critical tool and as a form of political engagement. Collectively, they provided a critical reflection on the planetary conditions of artistic production, circulation, and reception. And this critical reflection is not easy. It requires a lot of work, intertwining the geographical, cultural, historical, and economic contexts in which art takes place. They also provided a critical reflection on global capitalism in order to explore the complex dynamics involved in relation, in the relation between the artist, the institution, and the audience. And in my view, the artistic works they analyzed offer alternative interpretive tools that promote a decolonial form of thinking and doing, which requires confronting and delinking from the colonial matrix of power. And the specters of colonialism continue to haunt our contemporary world, and our world is deeply scarred by old and new colonialisms, marginalization, social inequality, environmental degradation, racisms and sexisms. And today's talks provided a critical analysis that attempts to deconstruct Western colonial hegemony, taking into account the other histories that are negated and repressed. And what's at stake here is not a nice, comforting integration of the missing chapters of the forgotten, excluded, and subaltern voices into inherited accounts, but rather a deconstruction and rewriting of those very histories and a recognition of an ecology of multiple belonging and radical post-humanism. So to warm up the conversation, I'd like to start asking our panelists to talk about the backstage of their research. Kind of what critical questions have driven you to do this particular research? Kind of just to talk about that process.
Is that a second? Yeah. All right. For me, a lot of my research for this project has been about looking at how indigenous artists think about decolonization and how they use certain indigenous artistic strategies in their work to think about decolonization. For me, this really came into my work through my own work as an artist. And when I first started the MFA program here, I started thinking about how are decolonial strategies used in art making, and that really started with thinking about how decolonial theorists were thinking about it. And a lot of them were really thinking about how do we de-link from the West? And that sounded like a really awesome thing to do. But the question remained was, how do we do that? And what does it mean to de-link? And if we de-link, what do we go towards? And that really started to become the question that I was kind of using to guide my work. And then thinking about, well, as indigenous artists, we have a history. As indigenous people, we have something we can look back to reconnect to. So that's really how I started to think about this. And for me, what that meant was about was remembering. And that's hard to do because as Chicanos, as indigenous people, colonization has been about forgetting. So it was really about remembering and doing the research within my own family and to find out what my own history was. And that's how I really kind of started to come into this research and thinking about as a Chicano, how are other indigenous artists using their own histories, their own traditions, their own practices, and sharing them. And that's why I really loved Dylan Miner's project, because he uses such a simple strategy of making bikes and incorporating indigenous aesthetics to helping young kids as young as like 15, 16 years old figure out what decolonization is.
Hi. Well, I think my path to this project has been very personal. As it said in my bio, I was born and raised in Boston, but I moved to Iceland as a teenager, and I've always been sort of, I always thought of myself as half and half. But I was always seen as, in Boston I was the Icelander, and in Iceland I was the American. And I was never quite satisfied with that. And I started seeing the same sort of descriptions of me in descriptions of artwork, which I found very fascinating. And I wanted to look for sort of the language to talk about that and to discover, you know, the forces that were causing this kind of discourse in both my personal life and in my professional life, or what has become my professional life, which is art. And ironically, some of the language that was being used by my colleagues in Iceland when I was working there really frustrated me, and I moved all the way to San Francisco to get away from it. And then I realized that just exacerbated the problem, and that that I really needed to confront it head on. And so this is sort of the one way I've found to do that, while also just learning about some of the artists I love and finding new ways to talk about their work.
Great.
Thank you very much for the question, Nigrin. Just like Jesus and Brindis, my research has been really personal, and it was paralleling my art practice as well. And I have been always interested in objects that are resisting to the power structures and resisting to the Western museums, and how can an object be a form of resistance. And at the same time, I was looking at an object that would exist in the system, but still try to break that system. So when I encountered Campbell's work, it was a perfect tool for me to explore this question furthermore. Thank you.
Great, thank you. So I have specific questions for the panelists. First, I'd like to ask Jesus about the bike as a symbol of liberation, which is linked to the movement and migration of indigenous peoples before colonization and the establishment of national borders. And I'd like to hear more about that.
Well, to start, I have to say that, yeah, Dylan Minor, when he thinks about the bike, the lowrider bike, and even the lowrider car, he's really thinking about migration because, as probably a lot of people know, the lowrider comes from Southern California, although some say from New Mexico, but that form has really spread all over the country and all over the world. I mean, if you look at Japan. But that really goes back to what he says is caused by migration, because as Chicanos have moved throughout the country by, because of their need for work through other places, they've taken that form with them and it's developed everywhere. And I think what how the lowrider is really tied to migration is really thinking about how were people able to move before colonial borders were set up. Movement came through necessity. It really came about moving from one place that was no longer viable for living to another place where people could set up. And I think that's how people, that's what people are kind of forced into today. Although today it's happening because of issues like globalization and capitalism, whereas back in the day, it was really just kind of caused by environmental changes or just by people kind of just wanting a change of scenery. But yeah, I think to me it's been really interesting to see how the bike has connected to different ways. And even I kind of mentioned a little bit with like the way the Red River Cart was set up. That was really used in a lot of migration that happened. It was created by the Métis to move around where they were living. And once they were kind of removed, that basically that form moved all over the Northwest, wherever the Métis went.
Great, thank you. And Ikin, for you, I have a question about the form itself, the essay film, which is inherently transgressive and self-reflective and self-reflexive, and it doesn't respect boundaries. And I was wondering whether you can talk a bit about that and how it informs the work itself.
Thank you. It further starts with reenactments and recreations of Statues Also Die, which is also an essay film. And it was a 1953 essay film which was banned because it was criticizing colonialism in France. And it's a really subversive form. And it's a perfect form for expressing subjectivity. So Campbell uses that really greatly. And it challenges, for example, traditional documentaries and how it has an authoritarian voice. Campbell says that this is my subjective voice, this is my own ideas, and I'm showing that this is not authoritative. So it resists that. At the same time, it forces the viewer to actively engage with the film because the visuals and the audio, the essay part, doesn't necessarily align with each other. So rather than just being a passive viewer, it creates awareness and it engages you with the film.
Great, thank you. And Brindis, for you, I'm really intrigued with the extended duration of the performance, which is 7 hours, and you cannot possibly consume it in its entirety. And it's, you know, the work is site-specific as well, so I was wondering whether you can talk about how the extended duration and site specificity can be thought about as a form of resistance.
Okay, well, let's see, one thing at a time. Site specificity. I think it's really interesting, for example, capstone is becoming more and more well known all over the world, and museums and galleries are starting to commission works from him, including the work that's at Palais de Tokyo. And he in an interview I conducted with him over Christmas, he was telling me about the process behind that. He basically wanted to talk about many of the same feelings he had talked about before, about romance and melancholy and other themes like that, but he wanted it to tailor it to Paris. Mm-hmm. So he created a scene that would speak to Parisians, in which two people wake up day after day and fall in love. And just do that for months on end for the entire duration of the show. And I think it's meaningful that, well, I think it's interesting that a lot of critics have sort of read this duration or this repetition of this little tidbit of a narrative as if it were emptying his work of meaning, as if sort of reveling in a tiny bit of a narrative or rolling around in it or even just sort of repeating a partiality might create meaning, might create abundance in and of itself. I think sort of restoring that in the way that I'm trying to do and the way that he is trying to do, Ragnar, is transgressive in its own right. Mm-hmm. I think it's interesting that he's not trying to create a work that's universally understood, in a sense. He's not trying to use a sort of Esperanto, mm-hmm. But he's using translation mm-hmm. In really interesting ways.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
And I'd like to open the floor for audience questions.
I'll ask a question. Okay, so how about this question of translation? Brindisi's last comment sort of alludes to it, because you said that he's not making works for a universal audience, although he does speak and sing in different languages. And I think for each of you, you're dealing with translation in your projects. Translations in terms of histories, past histories into our present, translation in terms of borrowings from previous practices, the essay film, translations in Brindisi, you're talking about even the notions of Iceland outside of Iceland. Maybe we could talk about that with each of the three of you, in any order.
That's interesting. Thanks for the question. With Native Kids Ride Bikes, there's a lot of translation going on, because for all the kids who participated in the project, the majority of them didn't grow up in their traditional communities. So these ideas that were introduced to them had to be translated in some sort of fashion, because these kids have grown up in this world where they've been taught to sit and watch TV, and they've learned the history that they've been taught in school, which is not usually an indigenous history. So for Dylan Minor to like really reach the kids, he had to take all these ideas, all these indigenous ideas, and almost work in a whole process to get these points across to these youth, to help them have a change of consciousness, to go from living in a world where they sit at home and watch TV to experience a world outside and work together to build bikes and go outside and ride them. So I think that there's this really interesting thing that's happening there with the way these ideas are being taken from traditional indigenous culture and then brought and introduced to our daily realities here. Yeah.
I mentioned before how Ragnar Kjartansson sort of translates between sites in each place he installs his work or creates a new work. But I think it's also very interesting how he translates through time. I don't know if he would agree with me, but I've sort of made it my business to say that he's translating this centuries-old artistic strategy for an international fine arts community that was in some ways very specific to Iceland, but is in other ways just perfect for the audience he's trying to address. Thank you.
We can consider it further as a filled with lots of translations, and this is the translation of history, the translation of other artists, other artworks, and the reenactments and recreations of other artworks, such as Stephen Shore's photographs or Michael Clark's dance scene. And I feel like through these translations, he, even though these things seem really separate from each other, for example, a dance scene or a photography from 1970s American road trip, all these create a dialectic method. At the same time, these shows that these seemingly incoherent parts are actually paralleling with each other because of capitalism.
Questions? Yeah, we have one here.
Got one for Professor Hennessy over here. Can I jump over here? I'm so sorry. Thanks.
My question is for Jesus and the lowrider bikes. I'm curious about the role of the museum in this work, and it seems that the heart of the work really happens outside of the museum space, and that the power of the work happens outside of the museum also. And so I'm wondering, like, what happens when those bikes go back into the museum after, you know, being built as a tool of resistance and sort of cultural, like this notion of cosmology that you talked about, everything that happens with the students. Like, what happens then when that goes back into the museum space and is framed in that particular location and history?
That's interesting. Thanks for your question. There's been a few iterations of the project, and the first one, which is the one I presented on, was really disconnected from the museum, and eventually it found a home at Michigan State University, where Minor teaches. But in later iterations, specifically one of them was like done with the MOCTA, with the Museum of Contemporary Native Arts. So in that space, it was really it was a really cool collaboration with the museum, where the museum was able to bring in the youth and have that kind of process happen. In other places, it's also been like this, where it's totally disconnected from the museum. And there was a set of bicycles that were part of one of the recent Detroit Now shows, where it was actually kind of a biennale, and it was actually, it won one of the jury awards, so it was really cool. But in cases like that, it's really interesting. And in talking with Miner, he has this this way of looking at his artwork entering other spaces, like that space. I forgot the name of the gallery where it was presented for that prize in Detroit. But what he talks about, which is really interesting, he says that although he likes to put that work in these spaces, these traditional museums, he says he believes that that actually inflicts violence on the work, because it's kind of, there's these two different worldviews that are going on, and obviously one of them is dominating. And he says that although he puts it, and he puts it in these places for people to learn about all this work that's happening, that it goes in there and psychically, spiritually, it commits violence on the work. So it's a real interesting thing that he does, that the museum can do to the work. And for him, he really tries to have his work presented in indigenous spaces, but you know, that's not always the case. Thank you.
We have time for one more question.
Okay, technology is power. I got to see the Kjartansson Rokeby Farm film. What's it called?
The Visitors?
Yeah, The Visitors in Boston, as a matter of fact. And this is like a 60 or 70 minute film that we went in to listen to 5 minutes of and stayed for 75. And we're accompanied by dozens or more than a dozen other people who had, I think, pretty much the same intentions. So I'm curious both, and I'm not sure if I can apply this to Aiken's presentation, but certainly to the lowrider as well, this idea of time, the way I hadn't thought of really lowriders as slowing time down, but in terms of decolonization and this kind of playing with cultural norms, can you, both of you, or and maybe all three of you, speak to how that actually plays out?
Thank you. That's a really good question. I don't know.
Do you want to start?
No.
Okay. All right. I've thought a lot about. I've heard many stories like yours where people go for 5 minutes but end up spending a whole day with his pieces. And that's something I actually speak about in my larger project, this sort of moment of engagement or this sort of like investment that a lot of audience members start to feel as with the repetitions, as sort of partiality becomes more abundant and emotional and sort of overflows. I speak about it as if it were a way of engaging people in a way that globalized or postmodern art might not. I'm not quite sure yet where that part of my work will end up, but I think it's really important to think about sort of the emotional investment that happens through time. I think it's really interesting that, for example, I could see The Visitors soon at SF MoMA, and again 10 years later in Russia, and pick up where I left off, but in a completely different context and probably in a different in emotional state and way. So I'm not sure, but that's where I'm at. Thank you.
All right, so I had time to think about an answer. So yeah, I mean, I think that idea with low writing is that it really thinks about slowing time down and taking time to look around. What it made me think of, though, is one of the things I've been considering in my thesis is about this idea of ceremonial time. In a certain way, I see artists work, indigenous artists working in a way that reflects ceremony. And for ceremony, you require kind of a special way of looking at time. And it doesn't mean that at this time you do this, and then, you know, 10 minutes later you do that. It's really everything happens as it needs to. And the ceremony itself determines the passage of time. And once you're in the ceremony, it's really about leaving yourself open to experience the ceremony as it takes you into another world. Yeah. Thanks.
We can talk in the break.
Well, thank you so much, and congratulations to our panelists.
Okay, don't get antsy now. Everything does happen as it needs to. That's the takeaway. And we want to kind of try to bring together ceremonial time and time for ceremony. That's also on a schedule here. And I will do my best to bring those two things together because I'm very honored to be part of this important ceremony for all of us as a community and for our graduating students and their support community. But I didn't want to say this before I supplicate Mike Rothfeld to come up here and launch our final ceremonial gesture in the auditorium, which has to do with recognizing alumni achievement, and specifically our alumni award winner, Andrea Dooley. Before doing that, I didn't want to do this during my acknowledgments because I didn't want to jinx the proceedings, which have been brilliant, but I just want to give a big shout out, and I invite you to applaud Michelle Carlson, who I didn't say this, but she's the one who really supports and coaches the oral presentation of our students, and has been doing such a wonderful job for many years of taking kind of the anxiety and converting it into intellectual energy and creative energy, and you've seen that here today. She's just the best.
No, thank you.
And then my last comment really has to do with an invitation after the alumni award to join us for a reception over across Hooper Street in the Hooper Grad Center in the atrium, where we can just kind of loosen our ties and talk to each other and continue with our questions and continue with exploring ceremonial time and what happens when it has to happen. And that's right, for those of you who aren't familiar with the campus, if you go back out through the nave and back out through the atrium to the front of this building and you turn right, the next structure you will see adjacent to this building is the Hooper Grad Center, and if you just go in the front door of that and walk down the hall, you'll find all kinds of libations waiting for you. So now Mike is going to tell you about the Alumni Award and then a member of the graduating class will introduce our awardee.
Hi. So, the VCS Alumni Award, also known as the VizCrit Alumni Award, serves to recognize a VCS alum whose work after graduation from CCA exemplifies the interdisciplinary and socially engaged values of the VCS program, as well as the nimbleness and ongoing scholarship required to operate within the ever-changing field of visual and critical studies. This award recognizes the innovative and diverse ways that VCS alumni mobilize the skills they honed and the ideas they germinated while at CCA in a broad range of creative and professional arenas, further evidencing the versatility of the degree and the luminosity of this community. The 2014 graduating cohort established the VCS Alumni Award as a way to reach out to VCS alumni and create a more engaged, robust VCS community network. To that end, each year's graduating VCS cohort is responsible for selecting that year's award recipient. We honor the awardee here at the program's end of year thesis event, the Spring Symposium, and in recognition of their achievements, invite them to address the VCS community. The awardee will also present their work in the fall at a VCS forum. Additionally, the awardee will be profiled by a VCS student and featured on the VCS website. Lastly, we present the recipient of the VCS Alumni Award with the coveted VCS bronze pencil. Commissioned by the VCS program, this solid bronze pencil is produced in CCA's own foundry by students under the tutelage of Professor Clay Jensen. I now invite the VCS graduating cohort of 2016 to the stage to present the 2016 VCS Alumni Award. Eden Redman will give a brief introduction of this year's recipient.
Thank you, Mike. This year, the Visual Critical Studies class of 2016 is thrilled to recognize alumni Andrea Dooley with our VCS Alumni Award. Andrea graduated from this program in 2006 and has since gone on to earn her PhD in cultural studies with a designated emphasis in African and African American studies from UC Davis. Her work is concerned with place and a role of the public museum and memorial in post-conflict societies. Focusing on genocide museums and memorials in Rwanda, her work considers genocide museums and memorial spaces that are offered up as strategies to foster a united Rwandan-ness. In an attempt to create cohesive community relations and shape post-conflict national identity, her research interrogates how questions of memory, the negotiation of difference in the aftermath of conflict, national belonging, and identity are mobilized in public spaces. We admire Andrea's dedication to academic inquiry and her value of the often contradictory or simply different needs of those who are living and have lived the experience. As you have seen here today, this value is central for many of us in the VCS practice. We are pleased today to present Andrea with this award and are humbled by the scholastic legacy that she has offered us. Please join me in welcoming Andrea Dooley.
Thank you so much. And congratulations, you guys. Thank you. Great work. Are you going to stay there, or you can stay there? No, no, you can. I'm really here for the bronze pencil, so I've achieved what I need to achieve here today. Thank you so much. It's so. Here, let me get my notes together since I dropped on the floor. It's really such a pleasure to be here, and I feel a little bit like I should have curtsied when I got my pencil. I feel really touched by you awarding me this honor. So thank you, Eden, for that introduction. That was really lovely. And I appreciate also, and thanks to Mike and Tirza for everything they do to create this space and this symposium. And Michelle, of course, who keeps it all running as it should. I also want to give a quick shout out to friends and who are in attendance who are also, in some cases, members of my original cohort at CCA when I was here in 2004 to 2006, who've remained such good friends. And as many of you know, if you've ever gone through the experience of being in graduate school, your cohort can really make or break you, or do both, depending on how it's going. And my cohorts, both here at CCA and at UC Davis, really made me a better scholar, a better colleague, a better friend, a better person. And so I want to just say thanks to them, too, who are here. I would also like to thank some people who were here when I was a student at CCA who really offered me so much, not only support, but encouragement and kindness. People like Kate Moore, Mabel Wilson, Karen Fiss, Lisa Finley, they also all made me as well. So I confess to having approached this with a little bit of trepidation, what to say about VCS and its impact on my work. And I think it's safe to say that my coming to study in VCS changed everything that happened after I studied in VCS. And I suspect there would not be something that I now call my work, which when people used to say that when I was a student at CCA, I would think, oh, my work, that seems stressful already. And I understand because I sat where you guys are sitting 10 years ago, having completed everything and you're sitting down in the audience now and someone is still talking. Why are they still talking? So I'll try to be brief and tell you what I feel like VCS taught me. And as always, I'm really invigorated in the interesting and provocative work that's being produced here at VCS. I try to always come to the symposiums every year and find it really heartening to know that there's a space of this kind of emerging scholarship. And the strength of this program, I believe, and its projects that are produced are no more evident than in the work presented today. And while on the surface, as unlikely as they might seem, in considering the sort of breadth of topics, connections and conversations and interesting dialogues can certainly be made. Connections that signal the movement of meanings, the recalibration of relations, moments that destabilize what is thinkable and possible. This is the poetry and the promise of the work, and it's this multivalency of meanings and scholarship that I see as the center of VCS. And what VCS taught me is to pay attention to the margins. I mean the word margins in all its iterations. Even the word margin is full of these intersections and interdisciplinarities. A margin can be sort of a typical financial collateral relationship, the margin of the stock market. Or it can be a village in northern Iran, or the zone on the ocean that marks the edge between the continental shelf and the ocean floor. It can even mean something such as the USS Margin, which was an SP-class naval patrol vessel in 1918, although if it's any indication about how my mind works, I looked at way too many pictures of SP-class naval vessels from the interwar period when considering the margin. And of course, the margins, as in the white space that surrounds the visual, the pictorial, the textual, the content of the page, and even marginalia, a word that means the mundane act of making a notation in the white space, which seems deceptively pedestrian, but is in fact a rational and, I would say, radical move, one that captures a thought, a question, a fleeting idea before it vanishes, a moment of defacement that is also a moment of relational and revelation, or the marginal, meaning in the edge of a territory, real or imagined, beyond which the no longer possible and the unacceptable finally finds a good rest. In fact, the margins tell us what is able to be done, the unending, the discursive, and the unthinkable. The margins, as Spivak wrote, is our beginning. If we want to start something, we must ignore that our starting point is all efforts taken shaky, she wrote. And if we are to get something done, we must ignore that all provisions made, the end will be inconclusive. This swampiness, that's what Spivak calls it, is a kind of recognition, what she calls a firm grounding in the margins of the beginning and the end. As I said, I feel like VCS taught me about the margins. So let me give you a brief, I know I keep saying that word, but I really mean it, example, because there's apparently drink available. And I, like you, would not like to be a barrier to that drink. So let me give you a brief example of the impact of CCA on my work and my first small move toward the margins. I came to CCA in the fall of 2004 with a small project in mind, a few preliminary questions, and absolutely no intention of pursuing any kind of academic career. So we can see how that worked out so far. In particular, I was interested in the material culture of memory, and as I took as my object of study, memorial and museum interventions that were being built in the emerging aftermath of the Rwandan genocide of 1994. It, in fact, was only about 10 years after the genocide, and when I arrived in genocide for some summer research, one of the museums had not even opened yet, and there were none that were actually finished. So it was really this emerging moment that I was interested in. And to be honest, this was a fairly concrete sort of forward trajectory of a project, something that was built on the concrete environment, buildings, the sites and objects of research. And there weren't that many margins in sight, or on site, if you want to get punny. Then I spent a summer doing field research in Rwanda between my first and second years of my VCS career. And after a few genocidaire and survivor interviews and a few visits to monumental mourning, I wrote this frantic email to Mabel Wilson, and I was writing it on a French keyboard, which made my already challenged spelling skills particularly bad, telling her that this could never be an academic exercise, that there was so much here that was, for lack of a better term that I had not yet learned, marginal. There were complexities, recalibrations in real time, the unknown and the possibly unknowable, about how communities grapple with the everydayness of the violence in the aftermath, of the insecure ways in which memory and life were made to be synchronous, that place actual cartographic location, place as the now and the real, had a more central role in redefining and reimagining Rwanda as a place and an idea in the wake of unspeakable communal state-sponsored genocidal violence. Mabel wrote me back pretty quickly, and she told me, in all caps, this is absolutely true, to calm down. Easy for her to say, she was using an English keyboard. But she wanted me to continue my research, and we would sort it all out when I got back. Welcome to the margins, she was trying to say. Encouraged by working with professors at CCA like Mabel, Karen, Lisa, and so many others, I began to look at those margins. While there's been much excellent scholarship and continues to be much excellent scholarship about the Rwandan genocide, its origins, historical positionings, its ties to the troubled and troubling memories of the genocide, very little had been written about the multivalent geographies of genocide, the lexicon of unimaginable relationalities in violence. I began to understand that along with the other ways in which the genocide unfolded, politically, socially, culturally, historically, rapidly devouring its victims and leaving carnage in its wake, it proceeded geographically as well. This coterminous and interconnectedness of place could be seen, I realized, in the genocide memorials in the local communities of Rwanda, where there are always pluralities, disconnections, reconnections, trajectories, and reforming relations. Therefore, my first understanding of Rwanda and the genocide, my first reading in the margins, was in and through the many meanings of place. Place that was understood, mobilized, and deployed in the aftermath in the effort to create a new Rwanda and a new post-conflict Rwandan citizen. In other words, I found that what a place is inextricably tied to what a place means, and are implicated in the workings of both that meaning and that being. This rethinking of place in the margins has allowed me to continually open up, expand, and renew my work, to call out the myriad ways in which interdisciplinary interrogation of both the genocide as an event and the ways in which the post-conflict imaginary mobilizes it to realize its own post-conflict aims. This education in the margins is a hallmark, in my opinion, of what I learned centrally at VCS. And so we take up the challenge, and as Derrida, yep, I just dropped the Derrida bomb, asks us to be present in the margins, a space, he argues, that allows us to work in an unauthorized way, to recognize and mobilize the shaky ground on which we stand. In the margins, we look for questions, not answers, find the improbable and the possible in restless coexistence. We do our work in the margins, and as is so evident by the work presented today by the graduates, congratulations again, it is work that finds common if shaky ground, with an interplay between the haptic, the unsettled, and the interrupted, a dialogue between the algorithmical and the archival, sight and the cyborg, the abject and the modern, indecipherable and materiality, the decolonial and the critical, the simulated screen and the soft sculpture, and art, because we learned today there is such a thing. Spaces like VCS and the work that we see here today teaches us to pay attention to the simply impossible intersections, to find alternative ways of seeing, to notice silences, erasures, and uneasy alliances. They ask us to attend to the margins. And so thank you, VCS, and thank you, class of 2016, for taking us to the margins. And thank you again for such a wonderful, wonderful award. Thank you.